Shalom, shalom, Jerusalem. Peace be to you. When Messiah comes.
Love is the principle of putting others first. And Jesus said things like this: greater love has no man than this, that a man would do what? Lay down his life for his friends. In John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he, what did he do? He gave. Now the final element of review, see if you can remember this. Ellen White, in that marvelous little statement, that pithy little statement, she says that the essence of worldliness is to get. That's exactly right. The essence of worldliness, the essence of selfishness is to get. It's me, it's more, and it's mine. But the essence of love is to give. So we find ourselves trapped between two competing principles, the principle of magnanimity and of grace and of love that wants to give, that wants to lavish affection, that wants to lavish attention, that wants to lavish grace, and the other principle that just wants to take more from me and mine, and it's I, right? So, with that sort of in mind, I'm going to ask you a question. That basically brings us up to speed with where we were at after last night. Let me ask you a simple question. If love is the principle of putting others first, are you all comfortable with that definition, by the way? That's a great definition, isn't it? One of the things I love about it, by the way, is that it shows us that love is not a feeling, right? Love is not an emotion. It has an emotional aspect. But love cannot be merely an emotion. Love is a principle. Love is a principle that is based on a choice that someone has made to put the needs, desires, and wants of others in front of oneself. Now, without sort of giving away the whole sermon here too early on, I want to share with you several passages that Paul sort of gives us an idea of what love is, and then we'll come back to the question I was going to ask you. We're going to look at several passages here in the writings of Paul, so get your Bibles out and get your fingers feeling nimble and dexterous. And we're going to look at a phrase that Paul uses repeatedly. Now, we're trying to be good, systematic theologians here as we put things very carefully, right? Very carefully back onto that table. We want to be sure that it passes the smell test, that it passes the God is love test. And we're going to look at several passages here. And the first one that we're going to go to is in Ephesians chapter 5. Let's go to, actually go to Galatians because it's before Ephesians. Go to Galatians chapter 1. And I'm just going to read several verses here, and I want you to see if you can pick up the repeated phrase, Galatians chapter 1. We'll find that in the New Testament. And I'm going to read verse 4, Galatians chapter 1, verse 4. I'm just going to quickly read through several passages. The first one is Galatians chapter 1, verse 4. We'll pick it up in verse 3. Grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father. Okay? Now we're going to stay in Galatians. We're going to go to chapter 2, verse 20. Stay in Galatians, chapter 2, verse 20. See if you can pick out the phrase, the Pauline phrase, that occurs in each of these passages. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Many of us would know this verse. Say it with me. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who lives, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Okay, that's our second passage. Some of you might have already picked up the phrase, but let's go to Ephesians, which is the very next book. Galatians, Ephesians, chapter 5. And here in Ephesians chapter 5, we're going to begin, our first passage will be verses 1 and 2. And Paul here says, as he's writing to the church in Ephesus, he says, therefore be imitators of God as dear children, right? And Paul here uses a very simple social and developmental observation, and that is that children tend to imitate and act like their parents. Isn't that true? That it's often the case that for example, I can remember even when my children were very young, I would stick my tongue out at my son, I'd say, and he would just instinctively, as a two-year-old or a one-year-old, he would stick his tongue back out at me. And I'd go, and he would go, and it was really quite fun to escalate. And you can now understand a little bit of the relationship that I have with my children. If you ever ask my wife how many children she has, she'll say, I have three. I have three boys, an older one and two younger ones. And so Paul here is sort of using this developmental social element of the fact that children have a propensity to imitate their parents. And so he says, verse 1, be imitators of God as dear children. And then for Paul, the moment that he tells somebody, act like God, act like God acts, what do you think would be the very first thing that he would say? I mean, if we're going to really act like God, we're going to be what kind of people? What do you think? That we're going to be, what was it? I heard somebody say it. Loving. And that's the very first thing he says. Look at verse 2. Therefore, be imitators of God as dear children, and say it with me, and walk in love. So I want you to appreciate the force of this. Paul says, imitate God, act like God, just as children imitate their parents. And the first thing that comes to his mind when he exhorts us and implores us to act like God is he says, walk in love. Now let's go on. Be imitators of God as your children, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. Now, if time allows and we're able to move through enough material toward the end of the presentation, toward the end of the week, we're going to talk about that phrase, a sweet-smelling aroma. But we'll see how quickly we can go. Okay, so notice what he says here. Walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given himself for us. Now stay in Ephesians 5 and go to chapter or verse 25. And this is a verse that many of us will know. We've heard it before. And it goes like this. Husbands, do you know this? Husbands, blank your wives. Husbands, love your wives as Christ also has loved us and given himself for us. Now, there are other passages that we could go to in Titus and in Timothy, but has anyone picked up the phrase? Yeah, that's right. Given himself. That's exactly right. So, now this is a recurrent phrase, and it doesn't just occur one time in Paul's writings or even two times, but multiple times, and Paul is writing in different circumstances under different on different occasions under different circumstances. He's writing to Titus. He uses the phrase, gave himself. He writes to Timothy. He uses the phrase, gave himself. He writes to the church in Galatia, gave himself. He writes to the church in Ephesians, gave himself. But a very important point for us here is take a look. You're still there in Ephesians chapter 5. Notice that Paul uses the phrase, gave himself, as an equivalence for something. Look at it again. Ephesians 5:25. Husbands, love your wives as Christ also, what? As Christ also loved the church and he gave himself. Okay, now look again at Ephesians 5, 1 and 2. Ephesians 5, 1 and 2, stay right there. Be imitators of God as dear children and walk in love as Christ also has loved us. And here's the equivalence, and gave himself for us. Now, I'll just remind you, you can turn there quickly if you're able to, Galatians 2:20, I'll just remind you of what it says. Listen, here's the equivalency again. Galatians 2:20, for I have been crucified with Christ, it is no longer I who lives, but Christ lives in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me, and here's our equivalence, and, okay, so what we've developed here is a very powerful understanding and a liberating, eye-opening, mind-blowing understanding of what love is. Love is not merely a feeling of attraction and affection that you feel for someone when you see them and you're attracted to. No. For Paul, for Jesus, and for the New Testament and the Old Testament Bible writers, and we're going to unpack this increasingly, love is a principle of giving oneself for the benefit, blessing, and upbuilding of another. In fact, Paul uses it exactly that way. He loved and he gave himself. He loved and he gave himself. He loved and he gave himself. And this brings to mind John chapter 3, verse 16. We just quickly remind ourselves of that again. For God, he didn't just love the world, but he what? He so loved the world. Well, what does love do? What does love do? Love gives that he gave his only begotten Son. So far, so good, everyone? Now, here's the tricky question. If love is the principle of putting others first, love, the essence of worldliness is to what? Get, and the essence of godliness is to give. Let's all say that together so it's in our minds. The essence of worldliness is to get. Oh, even she knows it. How old are you? 6 years old and she's got it. Look at that. Okay, so the essence of worldliness is to what, young lady? The worldliness is to get, and the essence of godliness is to give. Do you see that, boys? Pay attention to that right there. I got my two boys down here taking notes because I told them that if afterward they could, let me see your notes so far. I told them that if afterwards they could, very good, Jabel. I told them that if they could tell me what the sermon was about, I'd give them a special treat. So they're down here very studiously listening to what Dad has to say. Okay, I'm not above a little manipulation, by the way. Okay, so the essence of worldliness is to get. The essence of godliness is to give. So far, so good? So now here's my trick question for you. If love is the principle of putting others first, we're comfortable with that, right? Then what does love require? The answer is within that first sentence. If the essence of, if love is the principle of putting others first, then what does love require? In order to have love, what must you have? Others. I heard several of you say it. That's exactly right. If love is the principle of putting others first, then in order to have love, you must have others upon which to bestow that love. Making sense? So now let's take this a step further. I'm going to just imagine, it'll be easy to imagine, because there's a line right down the middle of this auditorium, okay? So we're just going to extend that line right down, we're going to pretend there's a very sharp line, okay? Just, it goes right up, right up here, and this line divides, we'll move this way, it divides pre-creation, God pre-creation, from this line is now God after creation, having created things, okay? So this is the post-creation universe where there's people like us, right? Where God has created other free moral agents, beings, Australians, right? South Australians and wild and wacky people from places like Cooper Pedy and other places, and America for that matter. Okay, so this is post-creation and this is pre-creation. Okay, so this is God over here before the first being was ever created. Okay, and for our purposes, we'll say that the first being that was ever created was Lucifer. That'll be, for our purposes, we'll say it was Lucifer. Now, could I borrow you, Landon, real quick? Do you mind being Lucifer in my illustration? Come on, you'll be fine. I'll get you later, Jabel. Okay, so this is Landon. Come on up here. Take your hat off. Okay. So here's Landon, and we're going to say that Landon is Lucifer, which I tell people that my children are angels. They're always angels. Sometimes they're fallen angels, but they are always angels. Okay, now here's the question I'm going to ask you. We'll say that in this illustration, well, you be God and I'll be Lucifer. Okay. So Landon is going to create me, right? So Landon represents God and I'm me. So here's the question that we have. Is God love before the creation of the first being upon which to bestow love? Oh, yeah, this is a bit of a timid yes. It's a pensive yes. It's a pregnant yes. Okay, let's try it again. Is God love before he creates Lucifer? You're more comfortable. Okay, now let's go back. Love is the principle of putting others first, so in order to have love, we must have others. Okay, so then what does this tell us about the nature of God? Oh, now we're getting somewhere. That's exactly right. Okay, you can go sit down now, Landon. That's exactly right. That God in his very nature must be a plurality. There must be others within the very nature of God. Now let's try and understand this. Let's explore this. By the way, this is Orthodox Christian belief. It's what sometimes referred to. What's the word that we sometimes use for this? The word the Trinity. That's right. And some people say, oh, the word Trinity doesn't occur in the Bible. I grant that. I completely grant that. The word is not there. But we're going to talk tonight about the idea. The idea, this, and all the word Trinity is trying to do is wrap language around a biblical idea, a biblical concept, and this biblical idea that we're going to be talking about for the rest of the evening is that God is not a rigid singularity. By the way, this is the cornerstone of religions like Islam, right? So let's just take Islam by way of comparison. In Islam, the fundamental tenet of the Islamic faith is that God is rigidly singular. Okay, in the most emphatic numerical sense of oneness, God is one. You with me? And of course, the second half of that is that Muhammad is his prophet. That Allah is one and that Muhammad is his prophet. Okay? And there are other religions that are rigidly, strictly monotheistic. Okay? Now, I'm going to ask you a question. You tell me what you think. If God is rigidly, numerically singular in the most emphatic sense of singularity, could this God be in his very nature and in his very essence love? Well, it would seem to be very difficult. Because if love is the principle of putting what? Others first. Love is the principle of saying, no, 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 not me, you. In order to say not me, you, there has to be a you to defer to. Now, here's something to think about. If you had this rigidly singular God who is absolutely one in the most emphatic sense of oneness, and he created Lucifer or he created another being, could that God then bestow love upon that being that he had created? Yes or no? If he chose to. Could he? Yeah. And do you know what you would say about this God? Do you know what you would say? You would say he's loving. Do you get it? If he chose, if he so chose to create another being or to create millions of beings and then treat them with kindness, with munificence, with magnanimity, and with grace, we could all say, what a loving God. But this is not what John says. John makes a far more profound claim. Not merely that God in his actions became loving, but that God in his very nature, God in his very essence, is love itself. But wait a minute. If love is the principle of putting others first, then in order to have love, there must be within the very nature and fiber and fabric of God, others. And this is exactly what the New Testament and the Old Testament in hints and suggestions, but certainly expressly in the New Testament, reveals, that God is a unity of three co-eternal persons, the heart of the Father, the heart of the Son, and the heart of the Spirit. And now check this out. The heart of the Father eternally goes out to the heart of the Son and the Spirit. He loves them. The heart of the Son eternally goes out to the Father and the Spirit. And the heart of the Spirit eternally goes out to the Father and the Son, so that verily we can look at God pre-creation. Before there's a Lucifer, before there's a David, before there's a Landon, before there's a you, before any created free moral agents were, we could look at God and we could say this three-word phrase, that's the first thing we're putting on the table, say it with me, God is love in his very nature. Love now is not merely something that God does. Love is something that what? God is. No wonder then, when sin, and we're just briefly stepping ahead of the story, we're going to get to this part tomorrow night. Mind-blowingly good news tomorrow night. But just no wonder when man was in trouble and when the human race was endangered and placed in peril, the very heart of God, the very nature of God longed to help. Not so much as a choice that was made, though certainly there was a choice that was made, but as the very outflowing of love, as the very outflowing of assistance, as the very outflowing of a desire to put oneself back and the other forward, God's heart leapt, as it were, into that void that was created when man rebelled. Just instantly. God didn't have to deliver, shall we or shall we not? No, it was instantaneous. The very heart of God longed to fill the gap, to bridge that chasm that had erupted between man. And I'm getting just slightly ahead of the story. Now, back to where we're at here. When we come to the New Testament, or the Old Testament, the first book of the Old Testament, let's go there together, Genesis chapter 1. We find that God creates in a marvelous way, and I wish we had time to sort of unfold all of Genesis chapter 1. We don't. But one thing that scholars have noted about Genesis chapter 1 is this really cool pattern of the way that God creates. And those of you that have read Genesis 1 several times over, you might have noted the pattern yourself. We find God creating a space and then filling a space. Maybe you've noticed that before. For example, it says that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters, etc. It then says that God said, let there be light, and there was light. And then it says that God created a space or a firmament in the midst of the waters, okay? So you have this watery mass, pre-creation earth. We don't know exactly what it looked like, but this is in as much as we can understand it. We have this great watery mass, and God, as it were, slides his hands into the watery mass, and he separates the waters above what he calls the firmament or the space from the waters that were below the firmament or the space, okay? And that firmament or that space is called heaven in creation, right? Probably the atmospheric heavens, right? So notice what God does. He creates a space. And then you know what he does? And then in the following days of creation, he fills that space with the sun and the moon and the stars. So he creates a space, he fills it, okay? Then he begins to create other spaces. For example, he gathers the earth together, the land, and the seas together. And so you have these huge watery masses, not as large as they are today before the flood, but still large masses of water. He creates this space, and then he fills the space with sea creatures and fish and other things. He then creates the land. Here's a space. He then fills the space, right? This is basically how God is creating in Genesis 1. Create a space, fill the space. Create a space, fill the space. Create a space, fill the space. And a fascinating thing happens in Genesis, in the seventh day of creation, Genesis chapter 2. God creates a space on the seventh day, but it's not a space in terms of dimensionality. He creates a different kind of space. What kind of a space is that? Yeah, he creates a space and time, which I wish we had time, pardon the pun, to develop just how insightful and perspicacious this is. Brilliant of God to create a space and time. We may pick that up later in the week. But do you know what God fills the Sabbath with? Himself. That's exactly right. All through the creation story, God creates a space. He then fills a space. God creates a space. In fact, when I was just in driving down through the middle from Darwin down, we stopped in Alice Springs. And I have to confess, I thought that Alice Springs would be like a gas station and a post office. So I was honestly a little disappointed to see like 10,000 or 20,000 people living in the middle of the desert. I was like, oh, this is a city. I kind of wanted it to be nothing out there. And I don't know, it's just my American mind. I thought there would be a gas station, and here's the big rock. But the big rock is actually quite a long ways away, and there's a lot of people living by that gas station. Well, anyway, we ended up losing our keys in Alice Springs, which was a bit unfortunate. And in the process of losing our keys, we ended up sort of walking around in the downtown area because we didn't go through... we had really no desire to do shopping and all of that kind of thing. We just wanted to get out in the outback and see lots of birds and sleep in the dirt under the stars and just get away from, well, you, civilization, right? Get away from people and just be out there. But on this particular occasion, because we lost our keys, we went wandering around through some of the shopping centers. And man, I tell you, we went to this one particular place where they had Aboriginal artwork. And I love art, but I particularly love patterns. And so I think I'm really predisposed to like Aboriginal art, especially Australian Aboriginal. So beautiful. And there was this one particular piece, and I should have bought it, the only problem being that it cost about $6,000. So I'm sure it's still there, and if you would like to make a donation to the Get David That Piece of Artwork, I'm sure you have more worthy things for your money to do. But in the unlikely event that you don't, I'm sure I could get it down here. Anyway, the point is this. I saw this piece of artwork, and I said to Violetta, man, I got to have that. That is so beautiful. That is so awesome. I need to own that. And so I went inside and I said, hey, you know, this piece of artwork in the you know, window here, what does that thing cost? She said, oh, you know, that's $6,000. I said, great. Can I take a picture of it? She said, no. Okay. So anyway, it's still there and it's beautiful. But the thing about it was, and the thing that I love so much about it, and I wish I had a picture so I could show it to you, it was a circle, right? Especially if you were standing kind of from a distance. It looked really awesome at a bit of a distance because it was just a black canvas. And it had all of these white dots, you know, in the sort of typical, you know, Aboriginal pointillism, which was, I just love that. But the dots on this, and the painting was quite large. It probably would have been about, a meter by a meter, maybe even slightly larger. And the whole thing was a circle, but it was many circles that when you stood at a distance, it almost just looked like one sort of circle. But when you came close, I mean, it must have consisted of hundreds of thousands of dots. Just teensy little dots that created this sort of circle within a circle within a circle. It was just, I'd never seen anything like it. It was just absolutely brilliant. And the closer, unlike some works of art, the closer that you got to it, the better it looked, right? Where sometimes you get up close and you think, oh, that doesn't look quite as nice. It looks better back here. This looked awesome from afar, and then even better the closer and closer that you got. And the reason that I loved it, and I said to my wife, I said, that, for some reason, it evokes to me creation. It just looks like I imagine all of these, this white and yellow dots, lights, right? Just sparkles of lights, and this earth beginning to be formed, beginning to be created. It just looked beautiful to me. And so in Genesis chapter 1, we see God, and he creates a space, and he fills that space. He creates a space, then he fills that space. He creates a physical space, then he fills it. And finally, on the last day, he creates a space and time, and he fills it with himself. And thus ends the creation week. Well, as part of the sort of consummation, the climax of creation, God says this wildly amazing, incomprehensible thing. He says, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Let them have dominion, right? Let them. Now, let's just try and understand this phrase as we prepare to close tonight. First of all, let us make man in our image. Let them have dominion. Okay, what do all of those pronouns have in common? Us, our, and them. They're all plural. You have us, which is plural. Then you have our, which is plural possessive. And then you have them, which is plural. So let us make man in our image. Let them have dominion. Now, the reason that this is a little strange sounding to us in English is because you have a singular antecedent noun. And God said, singular, let us. Right? There's almost an apparent grammatical contradiction here, because we have a pronoun, us and our, that doesn't seem to agree with the antecedent noun, which is singular. Your pronoun is plural, but your noun is singular. God said, let us. Except in the Hebrew, it's very clear. Because the word here for God is the word Elohim. Elohim, which is the plural for God. Right? So even though it wouldn't make a lot of sense in the English either, and it would send us in the wrong direction, another way of rendering this would be, and God's said, let us make man. And now we have correspondence here between the antecedent noun, plural, and the pronouns, plural. God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness. Elohim. God creates here. And I want to try and understand what this means. Let us make man in our image. Now, I hate to put any of you ladies on the spot here, and I should have done this before, but does anyone in this room have a mirror? Just a makeup mirror, or just anything, little mirror in your purse you could quickly pull out? Or any of you dudes? I just can't imagine. My picture of an Australian guy is that you would not have a mirror on your person. Can I borrow that? I mean, I've seen Crocodile Dundee enough to know that you shave with Bowie knives. So you don't have a mirror in your... Okay, I could borrow that. You don't mind? Okay, thank you so much. Okay. Yep, looking just as good as I remember. Okay. Can I borrow you, Nikki, just for a second? And Jabel, can I borrow you? Okay. Thank you so kindly for the mirror. What's your name? What is it? Casey. Okay. So, Jabel, come on up here. I need you. This is going to be very hard for you. I just need you to hold this and hold still. That'll be the hard part. See, turn like that. Okay, you just hold still. Okay, and put it right there. Yeah, that's good, right there. Okay, hold it. Okay, now, Nikki, I need you to look in there. All right, there you go. Okay, perfect. Okay, now, when I look, standing sort of over here, hold it still, JJ. Okay, when I look, I can see Nikki, right there. Okay, now I'm going to ask you a question, see if you can get this right. Is that right there, Nikki? But I see her right there. Is that Nikki right there? Okay, what is that? Okay, that's Nikki's image. But now follow this very carefully. If this mirror is telling me the truth, right? If it's a good mirror, if it's an act, not one of those mirrors that makes you look really fat, right? Which it doesn't, by the way, or really skinny. But if it's a good mirror, if it's an accurate image producer, okay, put it back up, JJ. Then what I see here, right there, will tell me a lot about this. Are you with me? In other words, while that isn't Nikki, I can learn a lot about Nikki by looking at the image. Are you with me? Yes or no? Okay, thanks guys so much. So what God did for us, the mirror that God gave to us, the thing that's in his image is what? I'm going to ask you again. What is the thing that God gave to us, the mirror, that's not God himself, but it's a picture, it's an image that gives us insights into God? What did he say? Let us make man in our image. Now let's take it a step further. So what was in the image of God? Was it males? Yeah, it was Adam and Eve, wasn't it? Male and female, he created them. Now I'm going to ask you a question, a bit of a Bible trivia question here, if there is such a thing as Bible trivia. What was the very first thing that God said to Adam and Eve, to both of them, in the Genesis 1 account? Yeah, be fruitful and multiply. That's exactly right. Make another. Right? Okay. So God creates a man and a woman, and he says, they are in my image. And the first thing that he says to the two of them, jointly in Genesis 1, is make another. We together, everyone? So what is it precisely that's in the image of God? It's a family. That's exactly right. The thing that is in the image of God is the family. That's when we look in the mirror, just as I was looking in the mirror and I could see Nikki, right? Because this mirror is an accurate mirror, it's doing a great job, by the way. Because this mirror is an accurate mirror, it's telling me something very significant about Casey. It can tell me the color of her eyes. It can tell me the straightness or the curliness of her hair. It could tell me a lot of things about Nikki because it's accurate. When God sets out to make something in his image, when God sets out to say, wow, I want people to know, I want beings, the entire onlooking universe, to be able to look at something and know what I am like, he could have created males. And incidentally, there are lots of beings in the biological realm that produce asexually, right? Where you don't have male and female that produce sexually, you just have asexual reproduction, where one sort of morphs into two, and then two sort of morph into four, and four sort of morph into eight, etc. God could have, had he so chosen, he could have created mankind as a asexual, non-gendered being, but he didn't. He could have made only men, but he didn't. He could have made only women, but he didn't. And he could have made some asexual creature, but he didn't. The thing that God made was a man and a woman, now listen very carefully, in a relationship. And the very first thing he said to them is, share your love, make another. So the thing, the real thing that is in the image of God, it's not a male or a female. It's a family. It's a what, everyone? It's a family. Incidentally, do you know what Ellen White says about the family? She says that a well-ordered and loving family is the most powerful evidence that can be advanced on behalf of the truthfulness of the Christian faith. More powerful than any sermon. If you see, in fact, incidentally, in my own personal conversion, June 6th, 1996, I was baptized. The events that led up to my conversion was a well-ordered and loving Seventh-day Adventist family opened up a vegetarian restaurant in my town, right? And before I knew anything about what Seventh-day Adventists believed, anything about the Sabbath or the sanctuary or Ellen White or any, before I knew anything, something about this family caught my eye and my attention. There was a wholesomeness, there was a beauty, there was a magnanimity, there was a selflessness and a love in this family. I saw something in the family that recommended the truth to me as something that seemed right, that seemed real, that seemed beautiful. And I've determined, ever since having become a Christian and then married my wife April 4th, 1999, and having given birth to two beautiful boys, I said, God, by your grace, may my family be a family like that. May it be a family that others could see, that my own siblings, I have two brothers and two sisters who are not believers and a mother and a father who are just some of the most wonderful, beautiful people you could ever meet. But may my brothers and sisters and those around me, may they see something in my family, in the way that I treat Violetta and the way that she treats me, in the way that we treat our children, the way that our children treat one another, and the way that our children treat their parents. May there be something in this familial relationship that causes people to say, man, that's beautiful. Are you with me? So what God makes in his image is a family. No wonder when we come, both the Old and the New Testaments, the Bible is saturated with this family language. I'll just give you a few examples. We just talked about the creation of Adam here. Go to Luke's genealogy, not Matthew's. We're going to go to Luke's genealogy because Matthew only goes back to Abraham. Matthew's genealogy is divided up into three parts. Abraham to David, David to the Babylonian captivity, and the Babylonian captivity to the Messiah. Okay, but Luke goes further back. And let's see how far back Luke goes in his genealogy. Luke chapter 3. Luke what chapter, everyone? Luke chapter 3. Okay, and take a look at, we'll pick it up in verse 35. Okay, so this is, Luke is bringing his genealogy to a close. And he says, the son of Sereg, the son of Rao, the son of Peleg, the son of Eber, the son of Shelah, the son of Canaan, the son of Arphaxad, the son of Shem, the son of Noah, the son of Lamech, the son of Methuselah, the son of Enoch, the son of Jared, the son of Mahalaleel, the son of Canaan, the son of Enosh, the son of Seth, the son of Adam. And then what does it say? The son of God. The son of God. Adam was God's son. Adam was the family of God extended. Every created being was. Now, I said something last night that you might not have gotten, but I'm going to repeat it here. God's love made creation. Creation did not make God loving. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit said among themselves, and as they communed together in love, they essentially said, I'm just going to speak in very human terms here. Paul says that several times in the New Testament. I speak as a human. Okay, so I'm just going to speak as a human here for a moment. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit essentially said, we've got a great thing going on here. Let's share this. Let's share this love that we have with others. And so when Adam was created, Adam, Luke says, was the Son of God. And an Eve was created. She would be the daughter of God. And then God essentially says to Adam and Eve, now you two love one another, and out of your love, another will come, be fruitful and multiply and share your love with them. In fact, when you boil the entire, all of Scripture down, Jesus said it, Paul said it, the Old Testament, Moses said it, the entire law, Jesus said, Paul said, and Moses said, can be summarized in two basic commandments. Okay, what's the first commandment? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. That's the command. What a strange command. Right? You would think a command would be to go there, to do this. No, but the command is to love. That's the first commandment, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. And the second commandment is very similar to it. It's to what? It's to love your neighbor as yourself. So God basically creates this marvelous forum, this marvelous venue in which love prospers and love grows, ever increasing. I love you, you love one another, you love me, you create others still to love, and God gives Adam and Eve the procreative capacity to create others who can create still others, and God just sees this matrix, this web of love growing and increasing, extending, giving itself. And of course this is interrupted. Of course, this is interrupted, but our point before we get into tomorrow's presentation is simply to summarize and say that Scripture is saturated with this family language because that's exactly what God made. God, as a family, made a family in His image. And so we come to the New Testament, we find passages like this. See if you can finish these passages. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the, yeah, you all know it, the sons and the children of God. Here's another one. John chapter 1, that's 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. Here's another one. John chapter 1, verse 12. To as many as received him, to them gave he the right to be called the sons and daughters of the children of God. So we have this language in all through Scripture, family language. Jesus' disciples overheard him praying, and man, they liked the way he prayed. Oh, there was something about the way that Jesus prayed. And so the disciples, they hadn't heard the Pharisees pray like this. This was not a dry formalism. This was not a mere vacuous ceremonialism. There was something substantive and beautiful in the way that Jesus prayed. And the disciples came and they said, teach us to pray how you pray. Oh, Jesus said, you want to pray like I pray? Yeah, we want to pray like you pray. Pray like this. Our Father. Bingo. Exactly. God is your Father. You are his sons. You are his daughters. This divine family has been interrupted, and that's what we're going to talk about tomorrow night. There has been a breach in this beautiful, familial, loving picture that God had created, and we're going to talk about that breach and how that breach has been remedied and how it reveals even more of God's love than would have been revealed had the breach not taken place. But for our purposes tonight, we find that God, as a family, created a family in his image. And it is only this kind of a God of whom it could be truly said, not merely that God is loving, but that God in his very nature, something about who he is love itself. To give, to extend, to help, to save, to bless, that it just, the heart of God just, it's not something artificial or manufactured by him. The heart of God just, it just flows out because it has been for eternity. The heart of the Father has flowed out to the Son and the Spirit. And the heart of the Son has flowed out to the Spirit and the Father. And the heart of the Spirit has flowed out to the Father and the Son. And out of that flowing, growing, grand thing called divine love, one day in eternity past, we don't know when, God said, let's make man like us. What did he make? He made a family. Amen? Now that picture is tragically, cruelly, terribly interrupted. And we're living in the middle of that interruption right now. We are living in the middle of a great big parenthesis. And that parenthesis is known as the great controversy. That conflict where we are being pulled and pushed and dragged between the essence of worldliness, which is to what? Get, and the essence of godliness, which is to what? That's where we're at. We're living in that parenthetical statement. We're living, as it were, in a pause in eternity. In a pause in eternity. But very shortly, this pause will be unpaused. This breach will be healed. The family of God will be reunited. And not just reunited, but reunited in a way that will be even better than if the breach had never happened. I know that sounds astonishing. We're going to talk about that later in the week. But we are going to be better off. The universe will be better off than it would have been had sin never come. I mean, God is going to heal. He's going to go beyond healing. He's going to achieve even more than recovery from the ruin wrought through sin. And God is going to get us back on to plan A. But in the meantime, that parenthesis is going to cost God very, very dearly. It's not just going to be instantly, quickly, no. This is going to be big. This is going to require a sacrifice within the very nature of God that no human being does understand or ever will fully understand.